Hello friends, welcome to GYAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently, we have 12 series that focus on your prelims and one series that target your mains. So what we do in these prelims oriented series, we daily pick up 2 to 3 topics, subtopics, and we daily discuss the MCQs related to them. And in this manner, nearly in 6 days, we cover all the 12 series. That 12 subtopics of your syllabus. So in a way, we have decided to separated your topics into the topic of whole syllabus of UPSC into 12 subtopics, and we daily discuss 2 to 3 topics. And in this manner, in 6 days, your 12 topics are completed, and this process goes on and on, and we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019, and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So let's start our discussion of this video series. So today is lecture number 2 of current affairs. So let's see what are the questions for today. First is, consider the following statements. First statement is, recently a rupees 11 crore deal was signed between Department of Biotechnology and the Energy and Research Institute to set up a center to produce advanced biofuels and biocommodities. Second is, this would be a first such center of its type in India. Third is, the biofuels are classified into 3 generations, that is first generation, second generation and third generation biofuels. So we have to choose the correct statement. So let me tell you friends that the first statement is correct. Yes, recently a deal of 11 crore was signed between Department of Biotechnology and the Energy and Research Institute. And regarding second statement, friends, second statement is incorrect, because it is not first such center. It is in fact fifth such center to be set up in India for the production of biofuels and other biotechnology. And third statement is correct. These biofuels are classified into 3 generations, that is first generation, second generation and third generation. First generation are those biofuels that are also that are produced from food crops, so they are used as eatables. Regarding second generation biofuels, they are produced from feedstock, so they are not eatables. Regarding third generation biofuels, they are produced from algae by a particular mechanism. So these are the third generation biofuels, and third generation biofuels have the advantage that it eliminates most of the drawbacks of first generation and second generation biofuels. So friends, we have to choose that which of the statements is correct. As I have told you, that second statement is incorrect, because it is not first such center, in fact it is fifth such center. So the answer is C, that is 1 and 3 only are correct. So the solution is C. So here you can see, this Department of Biotechnology has signed a 3-year 11 crore deal with the Energy and Research Institute to set up a center to produce advanced biofuels and biocommodities. And the key facts are that it is fifth such dedicated center for bioenergy research and development set up by the department. Others are already located at the Indian Agriculture Research Institute, New Delhi, the Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati, and the Transtech Green Power Limited, Jaipur, and the Oil and Natural Gas Energy Center in National Capital Region. So basically, the bio center is not just focused on developing the technology, but also commercializing it, as well as it envisages to produce bioproducts of this fuel, for example food, feed, nutrition supplements, bioplastics and novelty specialty chemicals. So this is about your question. So significance is that biofuels, what is the significance of biofuels in present day India? So friends, we have an ambitious program of Make in India, and also the policy making in India is highly focusing on waste to energy, and also we have focus on employment generation, as well as renewable energy sources, as well as clean energy sources. Including this, we have the target of doubling the farmers' income by 2022. So also we import a considerable amount of our energy needs from foreign countries. So we want to reduce the imports and also to manage our current account deficit. So in keeping these in mind, we have a considerable amount of importance in our India. So classification is basically, it is of 3 types, as I have told you. First generation biofuels, they are also called conventional biofuels, and these are all for food products. Regarding second generation food biofuels, they are produced from sustainable feedstock, and they are not a food crop, though certain food products can become second generation fuels when they are no longer useful for consumption. So this is about your Second generation biofuels. So important point to note here is that certain food products can become second generation fuels when they are no longer useful for consumption. It means when they have already been used for multiple times for the food consumption, then they are no longer then they could no now they could no longer be used for consumption. Otherwise, it would cause the harm to the health. Then they become second generation fuels. And third generation fuels are derived from algae and by a particular mechanism, unique mechanism. And they have the advantage that they mitigate most of the drawbacks of first and second generation biofuels. Let's move on to the second question. Second question is consider the following statements about vehicle location tracking devices. So vehicle location tracking devices. So friends, we have to consider the statements about it. First, recently Ministry of Road Transport and Highways notified that all new public vehicles registered after 31st March will have to be mandatorily equipped with such devices along with panic, emergency button. Second, auto rickshaws and e-rickshaws are however excluded from this mandatory requirement, and these devices, the device manufacturers would be required to get these devices tested for conformity of production every year from the testing agency. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that the first statement is wrong. Most of the students will get confused, but let me tell you that Ministry of Road Transport and Highways had issued a notification to that all new public vehicles they must have this mandatory they must be mandatorily equipped with such devices, but the date of that thing is 1st January 2019. So all the vehicles that are sold on and after 1st January 2019, they must have these panic buttons, emergency buttons, as well as your vehicle location tracking devices, which would be fitted in them by the companies that manufacture or the dealers that distribute these tracking devices. And they also have the responsibility to ensure that the signals are linked properly, and the vehicles, the details of vehicles are properly kind of managed, in which these devices have to be fitted. Regarding second statement, yes friends, second statement is correct. Auto rickshaws and e-rickshaws have been excluded from this mandatory requirement. And also friends, third statement is also correct, that these device manufacturers are required to get tested their devices every year from proper testing agency. So the solution would be second and third only. So the solution here is A. So first is not correct because the date has not been correctly mentioned. It is 1st January 2019. So this notification was issued in approximately November month. So it said that excluding rickshaws, auto rickshaws and e-rickshaws, all the public service vehicles that are to be registered on and after January 1, 2019, they must have this vehicle location tracking and emergency buttons. In case of older public vehicles, it said that it is the responsibility of state governments to recommend appropriate dates or appropriate time by which these vehicles must have these vehicle location tracking devices and panic buttons. So the operational procedure is basically not much cumbersome. It is simply these VLT come emergency buttons. They have to be fitted by these VLT device manufacturers, and the states have the responsibility while the states issue the registration certificate, or for that matter fitness certificates. They must ensure that these devices are working properly. Otherwise, this fitness certificates will not be issued to public service vehicles. And also there would be setting up of command and control centers. They would be set up by state or VLT manufacturers or any other agency authorized by state government. So these command and control centers will do when there will be kind of pressing of button, emergency button or panic button or usage of this vehicle location tracking devices, then this command and control signal will control center will receive the signal, and it will ultimately act as an interface between the emergency response teams and this vehicle location tracking devices. So it will be a kind of interface such as state emergency response center, transport department or regional transport offices and its designated agencies. So these centers also provide, they will also provide feed to the Vahan database or the relevant database of the state with regard to over speeding device health status. And this is about your role of various stakeholders, basically role of VLC device manufacturers to ensure that they install them in all public surface vehicles, as well as they along with their other responsibility is to register these devices, as well as along with the details of the vehicle in which they are fitted on the corresponding backend systems in the real time, so that when a particular VLT device is used, it must be clear that from which vehicle it has been the signals have come. So for the purpose of effective response. So after and the second thing is that public service vehicle owners have to ensure that these devices are working properly, and they are sending regularly the required data to the corresponding backend system. And the VLT device manufacturers have also the responsibility to get their devices tested every year after the first certification from the testing agencies referred to in the rule number 126 of the Central Motor Vehicles Rule 1989. And the testing agencies have the responsibility to ensure that they issue fitness certification only after ensuring that they are meeting the criteria. And also these state or union territories, they have the responsibility of publishing internet protocol address and short-term message service gateway, so SMS gateway. So what this internet protocol address will do, this internet protocol address will ensure that the traveler the passengers in the vehicle, they can use this address to use these tracking devices, as well as they can message or press the panic button through which the signal will be sent to your control and command center, and then through this command and control center the message service gateway will deliver this message to the emergency response center. So this will help in effective response. So this is about your second statement. Let's move on to the third statement. Third statement is, third question is, consider the following about UDAN scheme. So we have to consider the statements about UDAN scheme. So UDAN is basically full form of Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik scheme. So it is a regional connectivity scheme. So we have to consider certain statements about it. First, its objective is to make air travel to India's tier 2 and tier 3 cities affordable. Second, government under this scheme incentivizes domestic airlines to flag off new flights to neglected areas by providing viability gap funding, and also the airlines are given exclusive rights to serve a particular area after bidding. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that all of these statements are correct. Basically, this UDAN scheme was launched to ensure that all the underserved areas or the unserved areas or cities, they get their importance in this airline map of India. So in order to promote the regional connectivity, the government also incentivizes domestic airlines to flag off new flights, and by providing viability gap funding, and also exclusive rights are given to airline operators to serve these particular areas after bidding, and they have to register, they have to kind of segregate a particular number of seats for with a predetermined price that is fixed by this by the Ministry of Civil Aviation. So this basically UDAN scheme is implemented by Ministry of Civil Aviation. So the answer that is correct is all or correct, that is D, 1, 2 and 3. So this is about your Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik scheme. So it is government's initiative to make air travel to India's tier 2 and 3 cities affordable, to connect the cities and remote regions on the aviation map, and also to offer incentives to airlines to flag off new flights in neglected areas by providing viability gap funding. And also it is after the bidding for exclusive rights to fly on the regional routes opened up under the scheme, these operators must sell a specific number of seats on each flight at a fixed fare of rupees 2500 for 1 hour of flying. In case of helicopter operations, first time helicopter operations, fares are capped at 2500 for a 30-minute flight. So regional connectivity scheme or UDAN scheme is implemented by Ministry of Civil Aviation. So please consider it. It is important. So the significance is basically that it will give a boost to the regional connectivity scheme, and also it will connect the remote areas of the country, and also will ensure that small and first time operators, they also get a considerable share in the passenger traffic. So they can also get benefit of this rapid growth in passenger traffic. Another thing is that it will reduce the burden on this road transport and railway transport. So fourth question is, consider the following statements about Ganga Gram project. First, it aims at developing new model villages on the banks of Ganga River to reduce pollution in River Ganga. Second, it will reduce the population burden of cities. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that both of these statements are totally illogical and that's wrong. There is no logic of these statements. They were just included for the sake of making a question. Let me tell you that aim is not to develop new model villages. Aim is to ensure the holistic development of the villages that are already on the banks of the Ganga River by ensuring that they follow the practices of proper their waste management, and but they follow the practices of water conservation as well as this their waste management, including other things like water conservation and reclaiming of your ponds and lakes. And this is the basically this project is about. So first statement is wrong. Regarding second statement is also wrong, friends, because it has no such goal of reducing the population burden of cities. So both are incorrect. So the answer would be none of them is correct. D. So solution is D. So here is explanation. So Ganga Gram project is implemented under the national your Namami Gange project, which is further implemented by National Clean Ganga program. So National Clean Action Plan for Ganga. So objectives of this project is to include solid and liquid waste management, renovation of ponds and water sources, and including water conservation projects, and promoting organic farming, horticulture, and promotion of medicinal plants. So it is part of larger program that is Namami Gange program. So about it is that it was launched as a mission to achieve the target of cleaning Ganga River in an effective manner with the involvement of all the stakeholders, and especially the five major Ganga basin states, that is Uttarakhand, UP, Jharkhand, Bihar, and West Bengal. So it envisages river surface cleaning, sewage treatment infrastructure, and riverfront development as in biodiversity and afforestation and public awareness. So this Namami Gange program is implemented by National Mission for Clean Ganga. So National Mission for Clean Ganga is implementing it, and its counterpart organizations at the state level are also implementing it. That is state program management groups. So the three trial mechanism has been created for the project monitoring of national program for Clean Ganga. So at the central level, there is a kind of national level committee. Mission for Clean Ganga at national level is headed by a task force, chaired by cabinet secretary, and then at state level is the committee constituted, which is to be chaired by chief secretary and registered by state program management groups at the state level. And also district level committee will be there, that will be chaired by the district magistrate. So the program emphasizes an improved coordination mechanism between various ministries and agencies of central and state governments. So this is about your fourth question. Let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, consider the following statements about strategic petroleum reserves. First, it is an idea that was first time mooted in 2014 to ensure availability of crude oil in the country in case of any disruption in energy supply. Second, these strategic reserves are built by a special purpose vehicle, that is India Strategic Petroleum Reserve Limited, a wholly owned subsidiary of Oil Industry Development Board under the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. So we have to choose the correct statement. So let me tell you, friends, that first statement is wrong, because it was not mooted in 2014. In fact, it was mooted during the time of Atal Bihari Vajpayee government in 1998. So the idea is quite old, but it has been now implemented with the government setting up a special purpose vehicle, that is India Strategic Petroleum Reserve Limited. So it is a government owned company that whose main business is to build crude oil storage storages which will be filled with the crude oil by the different stakeholders, in order to ensure that India has continuous access to the energy in case of any external disruption. So only second statement is correct. So the answer is B, that is second only. So here is the explanation. So basically, the question is in the context of recent Union Cabinet decision, which has approved filling of Padur Strategic Petroleum Reserve, which is in Karnataka, and it is to be filled by the National Oil Company of Abu Dhabi, that is United Arab Emirates. So Padur Strategic Petroleum Reserve has a capacity of 2.5 million metric tons, and besides this strategic storage capacity, we have also two other places where we have the such type of strategic storage storages that are built by this India Strategic Petroleum Reserve. They are in Visakhapatnam, and one is in your That's the name of that is Mangalore. It is in Mangalore. So currently we have 5.33 million tons of underground reserves in three locations, and this is in Padur, that is 2.5 million metric tons, and others are in Visakhapatnam in Andhra Pradesh, and half of the other facility in Mangalore in Karnataka, while leasing other half to the Abu Dhabi National Oil Company. So about this program is that currently India has decided to build 5 million metric tons of your strategic crude oil reserves, and for this purpose the strategic crude oil storages would have to be built, which are to be built by your this India Strategic Petroleum Reserve Limited, which is a government owned company under your Ministry of under the Oil Industry Development Board, which is further under the aegis of Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. And in the budget of 2017-18, the government of India announced further two more such strategic storages that were to be built, in one in Rajasthan and one in Odisha. So in Rajasthan, the place is to be, where it was to be built is Bikaner, and in Odisha the place is Chandikhole in Jajpur district. So the basic purpose is basically to ensure that India's energy security is not threatened by any external disruption to the energy supply. So as in the situation of 1990s, when the Gulf War erupted in the West Asia, India was kind of facing a serious and threatening oil crisis, energy crisis, for this purpose, to ensure that we do not face such situation again, the government of India has decided to start building up such storage capacities, and already three places we have built it, and we are coming with two more places, that is in Chandikhole and your Bikaner in Rajasthan. So we are quite dependent upon your fossil fuels. So 80% of these fuels are met from imports. Also, in order to reduce the burden on external sources and to make strategic economy, this program will help us. So this is all about friends today's lecture of current affairs. If you like the video, if you like the questions, then please do like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel, and also do not forget to press the bell icon. But in case you and friends, in case you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, you can contact us at this email ID, that is achieveis21@gmail.com, or at this number, that is 8968426481. So you can contact us at this number. There will be a minimum cost which we will charge for the purpose of the PDF subscription, and that fees is kept as minimum as possible and for the purpose of our motivation. So if you wish to subscribe to PDFs, you can contact us at this email ID or at this contact number. So this is all about friends today's lecture. Thank you very much. Have a